One of the most important parts of my process when it comes to making not only just my ski videos, but all of my videos in general is the editing. I've made a video on my GoPro camera setup, my GoPro settings that I use, and in this episode, I'm gonna be bringing it all together and talking about how I actually edit all of my GoPro footage. This is going to be a super abbreviated video, as I'm gonna try to fit in everything from the actual importing of the footage all the way down to the final export. Now, I use Adobe Premiere Pro, but I do think there are some fundamentals you could use from this video, even if you use Final Cut or DaVinci Resolve or even iMovie. One of the first things you need to do when you open a project in Adobe Premiere Pro is actually bring in your footage so that you have something to work with. You can import your footage a few ways, but the way I'm gonna do it is just by double clicking down here in the project bin, and it's gonna basically bring up like a file browser, and from here I'm going to find the footage that I need to pull in here. It's really important to have a good file management system, because the way Adobe works in general is by linking the media, whether it's a photo in Photoshop or in this case a video file, to Premiere. So if you move the files once you've imported them from the location, the links are going to be broken, and then you're going to be stuck trying to locate the file so that Adobe can recognize where the project is. Once you have your footage imported into Premiere, the next thing you're going to have to do is create a timeline or a sequence that basically serves as sort of like your artboard or your place where you're going to start loading your clips and actually making your video. So to do this, I'm going to come down to this little page icon here, new sequence right here. And then it kind of brings you up with a list of different types of sequences and names. Basically, 99% of the videos I make on YouTube, I use a DSLR 1080p 24 frames timeline. And you can see in the settings here, this is 1920 by 1080 at 23.976 frames per second. I like to rename this to something just so I can keep them all straight, but let's just say how to edit, and hit OK. And you will see that now a sequence has been populated down here that has a few different types of tracks. If I start with this clip here from Mary's Nipple, this was a hike in Grand Targhee. This is a basic sort of talking clip that I might do before I actually drop into the run. So if I just click this little drag video only icon and bring it into the sequence here, you're gonna notice that it comes up with this message saying that the clip is mismatched. And this is because our sequence is 1920 by 1080, and this clip that I'm bringing in is actually a 4K clip. So we're just gonna keep our existing settings so it doesn't change. And you're gonna notice now the clip is super zoomed in. If you can look here on the left, the actual clip is a lot more wide, right? And this is really zoomed in on my face. So in order to fix this, if I come over here to effect controls and come over to motion, I can scale down and decrease the scale of the clip until it fits the frame exactly how we want. So it looks like somewhere maybe in the 49 range, maybe even 50 just to be safe, will work. And then because this is a 4:3 aspect ratio instead of our 16:9, I can actually adjust the position a little bit, and you can see I can really frame the clip so it's just about exactly where I want it. If I want to have my head cam in there, or maybe I don't want to cut the head cam off a little bit, I have all that flexibility to make sure I get the best composition that I can for the shot. So now if we just play this clip through, I know it is a talking clip of me describing probably how beautiful it is back there or something. You can see that it is relatively flat, and it's just not really correct, and it's kind of just unimpressive from a technical and cinematic or high quality standpoint. So the first thing I typically do with my GoPro clips is the coloring process. This is what got me into video stuff, and it's just something I really, really enjoy doing. Like with everything in this whole process that I'm showing you, there are tons of ways to do the same thing. So I'm not saying this is the best way or this is the correct way to do it. This is just the way that I've done it for years now, that I feel like I can provide good results while still being timely and effective in sort of my editing process. I heavily rely on the Lumetri scopes when I color, and they are located up here next to the effect controls. If you don't have the Lumetri scopes, you can come up to window, and they're usually in this sort of area here. You can see Lumetri scopes is clipped on. The two scopes I use for all of my coloring, whether it is the GoPro footage or Canon footage, drone footage, is the RGB waveform and the YUV vector scope, these two right here. These may look more complicated than they really are, but this one on the left is basically showing our tonal ranges from all the way bright up here at 100 to all the way dark here at 0, with a color hue in there as well. And this one on the right is basically just showing the overall spread of the colors, what colors are saturated, what colors are not, and just the general balance of the color wheel. Because I have the GoPro set to shoot in a flat color profile, more often than not, we need to expand our dynamic range. We need to increase the contrast. We need to make our whites brighter, our blacks darker, and just overall increase the saturation. Luckily, the GoPro footage is relatively easy to color, and at this point, I've created presets and sort of shortcuts or filters, you could say, to help expedite the process. But I wanna go through one completely manual by hand so you have a feel for what we do to a clip to make sure it has its best potential or just looks the best we can make it. So I have all of my Lumetri color here on the side. Again, if you don't see Lumetri color in Premiere, again, it is in your window selection here, but even if you aren't using Premiere, you can still use these same principles. For instance, if we start here with the basic correction, I typically start by bringing my white point up, and you can see how the scope on the left side changes. This just reads left to right. So on the left side of the scope is this area right here. This is the light on the mountaintop right here. And this really dark area is in here in the coat. So just read this left to right. You can see as I bring my white point up, you can see we start to hit 100. The idea with this is that you don't want anything to ever really hit 100 and nothing to really hit zero. Because once you're in those areas, you technically don't have any more detail, and it just looks either completely bright and washed out or completely dark and just really muddy. So the whole idea with coloring is that you want to kind of maximize the area here and push things to the edge of each side, if that makes sense. Now each clip is different depending on your lighting scenario and what exactly it is you're shooting, so you can't necessarily apply these settings to your clips and expect the same results. But if you think through this stuff, it's honestly pretty simple. So if we just bring our whites up a little bit here, I might blow out the light on the mountain a little bit because again, that's not really important in this case. So I might just bring these up a little bit in here, maybe to like 40. And I'm doing this off the cuff right here as we're going along. I do see that my coat is pretty dark, and you can see that here in the scopes. So if I bring up my shadows a little bit, you'll see how that detail really starts to get relieved. And you can see my coat, you can see my backpack, things like that. If you go too much, it starts to look too washed out and just fake. So I think there's a fine line in here. If we come up maybe to around 40 as well. And then because we lifted the shadows, just to keep our contrast in there, maybe if we bring our black point down just a little bit, again, we don't want it to really touch zero. So I think maybe somewhere right in that range. I didn't really do much to it, but that's kind of where we're at now. And then I might just add a little bit of contrast here to add some more juice to it. I mean, you can see just by those four sliders, if we enable and disable Lumetri color, that's what we started with, and this is what we're at now. So it clips a little bit brighter, a little bit punchier, and I think overall just has more range and detail to what you would see with your eye. So the last thing I wanna do here, just in this basic tab, is just increase the saturation. Typically with GoPro stuff, I find like 140 works pretty well, but you do have to be careful with the skin tone. You can see, I think the skin tone is a little bit hot, a little bit too orange, but we'll fix that later on. So let's just start with 140, basic correction. The white balance looks good. The snow looks nice and white because we set our white balance. Maybe I could cool it down just a skosh in here. But again, before, after. If we move right along down here, really the only thing I do in creative is add some sharpening. Because I turn the sharpening down on my GoPro, I do add about 30 to 40 sharpening. Just, I don't think it does too much, but that way we can just make it so it's not as soft with the GoPro. The curves here is a big section that can be kind of confusing, but again, it is the same thing kind of that we just did up in the basic correction here. This basically just controls your brightest values and your darkest values and everything in between. So if I pull this top point here, you can see how the whites just get absolutely blown out. And if I pull it down, you can see how they get darker. Same thing down here on my black point. I can either completely, whoa, come here, crush the blacks really, really dark. I can lift them up and make them almost gray. So again, there's a fine line here, but if we just kind of add a simple S curve is typically what I like to do for the most part. You can see if I go too much, we're starting to lose the detail on my coat. So maybe just somewhere in there. I like my stuff pretty punchy and contrasty, saturated, stuff like that. So that's just the style I like to go for. But if I just disable and enable this tone curve, you can see it really just adds some more punch to the overall image. I talked about my skin tone being a little bit too saturated. So this hue saturation curve allows us to do selective color adjustment. So I can do hue versus saturation here, and actually eye pick and go right to my skin tone here. And now if I drag this color down, you'll see all of the oranges in the image are are taking out. So without affecting the sky and everything else, I can just kind of pull my skin tone down just a little bit here so it's not, so I don't look like an Oompa Loompa. Skin tone is definitely the thing that is the most representative of your color. So if your skin tone looks off, everything else is gonna look off. So if I just kind of drop my skin tone just a little bit and just kind of pull some of that orange out, I think that looks just fine. And that's really the most I'll do for coloring just a basic GoPro clip like this. I don't wanna spend too much time on it because then you just won't ever get anything done. But again, if we look at a before and after, you'll see how the clip is just a lot, just looks a lot better. It almost looked okay at the start, but you can see once we added these adjustments, now the clip is brighter, it has more dynamic range, it's more saturated, and it just looks more realistic. So even if I take other cameras and other shots, such as this head cam stuff, if we just select a little section here, and I pull this into the timeline here, and I do the same exact thing, and just kind of mess around with some of these sliders, I can get a very similar look. So the principles are the same. I'm using my scopes here, trying to see where the detail is, where the detail isn't, increasing the saturation here. This clip is a lot different because there's no sun, so the colors are different, things like that. But really, it doesn't matter what clip I take. I can even take this Alta clip of me hiking up the hike here, and do the same exact thing. Again, this Canon clip is super, super flat. So if I increase the saturation here, you can see I start to bring the color and you can see how scrunched up that scope is. So let's really expand the scope here. The clip looks a little warm, so we can kind of bring in some blues here to really hint on the winter cold aspect. And just literally in a matter of a few seconds, we have a clip that went from this, which is super flat, to now something like this. I am clearly rushing through this, and I would spend way more time in making sure the colors are right. But you can see just with a few adjustments, I've taken a clip like this and brought it to this, using the same principles of just maximizing our dynamic range and making sure our colors are where we want them to go. One of the other things I really love to incorporate into my videos, whether it's my ski videos or not, is something called speed ramping. This is essentially when a clip goes from fast to slow and back to fast motion again, or from slow to fast back to slow. Doesn't really matter. Now, because we shoot everything at a high frame rate, either 60 frames a second or even 120 frames a second, we essentially have extra frames to use when we're editing in 24 frames a second. So if we are shooting in 120 frames per second, we have 5 times the amount of frames that we need to fill the 24 frames per second timeline. If we're shooting in at 60 frames per second, we have nearly 2.5 times the frames that we need. So if you aren't shooting in a high frame rate, your slow motion is gonna look really choppy and almost like it's lagging. So that's why it's so important to shoot in a high frame rate so you have the ability to do slow motion and speed ramping later on. If you notice, this clip here called Jupiter Peak is actually at a frame rate of 119.88 frames per second, or 120 frames a second. So there's a specific spot here that I really like, and it's when I ski through the trees right here. So if we kind of just select this part of the clip, we hit our in, boom, we hit our out, and we have this clip. It's only 3 seconds long, but if we drag this into our timeline, do our resizing that we talked about earlier in the video, so I can come basically to about here, 70%, and we can play this back. Boom, we come through the trees, done. And that is in the real speed, real motion. So I'm just gonna add a really quick preset that I made, GoPro. Let's see, this might not really work very well, but I think it kind of does the trick. So again, that's where presets work really well, just kind of brightens everything up. I do think this might be just a little bit too yellow, but we can fix that pretty quickly. Oh, it's a little green, so we might just add a few magenta and boom, just like that, it's fixed. With 2 clips of magenta, our snow is nice and white. So that's kind of an example of how I use my preset. Again, you can see the sliders are all changed here, things like that. But boom, now we have a good looking GoPro clip to at least get started. So if we zoom in on our clip here, the way I'm gonna do this is I right click on this FX button here, time remapping speed. So now what I did was I changed the keyframes to represent speed rather than opacity. So now what we have to do is we have to find where we want it to start slow motion. So I come in, boom, maybe like right here, let's start slow motion. I'm gonna come over to this little diamond here on the track, add or remove keyframe. I click on this button here and you'll see that it adds this, this little dash or this hyphen. And now what it's done is it's added a keyframe here and I have the ability now to adjust the speed on either side of this keyframe. Because I want everything forward of this to be slow motion, I'm gonna adjust this line here. Now, because 120 frames is 5 times the amount of 24 frames, I need to slow this down to 20%. We're at 100% speed. We need to go down 5 times to 20%. This might be confusing. Pause the video, watch it back. I swear it'll make some sense the more you do it. So if I pull this side down, you can see our ticker going down. Let's go right to 20%. 20%. Now, when we play it back, here we come. Boom, slow motion the whole time. Now we're at 20%, super slow motion, right? Bum, bum, bum. Okay, that's what we want. Slow motion, we land, and then we're gonna go back to fast motion. So all we need to do is add another keyframe and bring that back up to 100. So right here maybe we'll add a keyframe and I'll lift this side up and bring this back to 100. Like that. Now we play this back. Here we go, we're skiing. Boom, slow motion through the trees, land, back to fast motion. If we wanna make this a little bit smoother, and the reason why I like using this method is that I can essentially expand our ramp here. Now you can see we can control the duration of how it eases in and eases out. I can adjust this little handlebar thing, and now it's not gonna be as harsh of a cut from 100 to 20 and back. So it kind of zooms in now, not zooms in, kind of like eases into it, and I can do the same thing where it kind of eases out and it isn't so abrupt. So now our clip looks like this. Ba-da. Yeah. Land, speed back up. And that's an example of speed ramping. So now once you start to add some banging music that you like and start to create a story, you can see how my overall sequences all start to come together and look something like this. Now the last step, once you have created your video or your vlog or whatever it is that you're doing, is you want to come up here to File, Export, Export Media, or you can hit Command M on your keyboard and it'll bring you up to this sort of export dialog box. Really all I do is I come to preset here, make sure you're on format H.264, come to preset here, and YouTube 1080p Full HD. I check render at maximum depth and use maximum render quality, and I just set where I want it to export. So let's export this to the desktop here, how to edit, save, and export, and now it'll start the export. So now you can share this with all your family, your friends, or whoever it is that wants to see your videos. Like I mentioned, this was extremely abbreviated. I feel bad because there's so much that I left out that you kind of need to know just in how to operate Premiere and just make videos in general. So you could honestly make videos on each topic, whether it's making a sequence or exporting. So if there's something that you really want to learn more about, whether it's color grading or learning how to read the scopes, drop a comment. I'd be happy to go more in depth on it. I just don't typically make tutorials or videos like this at all. So I hope you guys enjoyed it and learned something. I got 2 new cameras that I'm excited to try out and share. And if you're on the live stream, you might've gotten a little preview for that, but thank you guys for watching. I hope everyone has a great weekend. If you enjoyed the video and learned something, don't forget to hit the thumbs up, and I'll see all of you guys in the next video. Take it easy, fam. Only like 2 more weeks till opening day. Peace out.